Obrigado, Musa. Obrigado, Anselmo. Sensacional, viu? Sensacional. Muito obrigado. Bom, continuando aqui com o Dream Team, né? O Dream Team aqui de atendimento 2013, mundial, internacional. É muito gratificante ver uma agência brasileira no meio desse Dream Team, né? Estamos construindo aí, aqui no Brasil, uma equipe sensacional. O próximo case é o case de Beauty Inside. Assim, é uma ideia fantástica, né? Uma ideia simplesmente maravilhosa e que eu sei que teve um poder de amplificação, um poder de participação do consumidor muito, muito bacana, muito legal, né? E vindo direto de São Francisco, estamos aqui com o Gary Toit. I hope you said, I said your last name correctly. O Gary Toit, por favor, Gary, VP de atendimento da Pereira Odel de São Francisco, Califórnia. E também a Billy Goldman, né, Senior Marketing Partner da Intel, que está vindo de Portland, Oregon. Né? Nossos dois palestrantes aqui. Aqui vamos fazer algo um pouco diferente, porque é a agência e cliente falando juntos sobre um case. Tá? Então, please, Gary, Billy, welcome.
Thank you.
Super. All yours.
Excited to be here.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you. Okay.
Do you want to sit? How do you want to? We'll share the stage.
We'll share the stage.
We're kind of
like
we're like an entertainment duo.
Yeah.
How you guys doing? Oi.
We're awake, right?
I know it's right before the break. I know you've heard a lot of presentations on how to do things right. I see some of you on your PDAs. We'll try to make it brief and try not to repeat too much of what we've heard. I have to say it is a little intimidating being on the stage with so much great work that I really, truly admire. Also, I'm with my client, so I can't bullshit as much. So, and you've heard the questions she asked, so.
I ask hard questions.
Keep that in mind when you critique these later today. Do you have the clicker? Thank you.
Green for forward, red for back.
Great. Yeah. Yep. So I really want to thank GA for putting this whole thing together. I've spent my entire life as an account guy working for advertising agencies. And there's probably not a month that goes by where I'm like, what the hell am I doing with my career? And it's work like you're going to see, well, like you've seen today, and like you're going to see that makes it all worthwhile. But having an organization that's bringing people together and really talking about what a craft that is really important. So Robert and your team, you really deserve a lot of credit, and please bring this to the US. So here's what we're gonna see today. We're gonna do a brief introduction. I work for Pereira Odel. You probably know Pijata. I'll talk a little bit about who we are. And then we're gonna get into this film series that we've created called Inside. This entire presentation is really a love letter to my best client, Billy Goldman. And I'm not just saying that because she's sitting here. All the ideals that you've heard from the other presenters, she really embodies it. She's fearless. She's smart. She's not afraid to tussle and argue and, at the end, come to an agreement. One of the things I really respect about her as a client is she knows the difference between collaboration and compromise. So, Billy, you rock.
Thank you.
You guys know who Intel is. You know who Toshiba is. How many people here know who Pereira Odel is?
Wow.
All right. I'm always shocked because I was there from the beginning, and here I am in Sao Paulo. I know Pajata's from here and everything, but that also makes me feel very, very good. I want to say something about human capital before we go any further. And I think it ties in to kind of with the Dove sketches. I have a unique perspective on Brazil because I work for a Brazilian company. Grupo ABC owns 51% of Pereira Odel. PJ has strong ties here, and we have a constant influx of Brazilian people. And they are some of my favorite people on the planet. And again, I'm not just saying that like Billy's sitting here, like you're sitting here, but something that you should never forget is it's walking through the streets of Sao Paulo, which are much safer than you all think they are. I'm walking down the streets of Sao Paulo. Everybody tells me, don't walk alone, Paul, don't walk alone. It's probably smart advice, but I had a really good time walking around. But there is an energy, there is an optimism, and this is the wrong word, but there's kind of like this naivete that's kind of like, you know, I don't really give a shit. I think this is a cool idea, and we're going to try to get it through. And some of the most rewarding work that I've ever been a part of has come from that attitude. So Brazil, you rock as well. So here's who we are. We started 5 years ago. We've built it up to about 140 people throughout all these offices. Our headquarters is in San Francisco. We also have a thriving agency in Sao Paulo. So not only are we going to be stealing people and taking them to the U.S., but we're also going to move them over to Sao Paulo as well. Sorry, Ogilvy. Here's my guys. Again, we've been around for about 5 years, and we've been extremely fortunate. We've had a great run and a great load of clients and interesting work. Here's our obligatory reel, and that's the last I'm going to talk about myself. Right, you guys still with me? Yeah. Oi! Okay. So here's Pajata, super talented guy and really inspiring person. Here he is on a book tour. Who knows when he has time to write books, but he's written three of them, and he just got home. He said it was a smashing success. One of the things I love about PJ is he has a way of kind of cutting to the quick. And it doesn't matter if it's a briefing situation or if it's in a senior staff meeting, but he has a way of just kind of summing things up. And one of the themes that we all live by at Prairodel is, what if advertising were invented today? So if we were sitting in a briefing with Billy we had never met before, we probably wouldn't be coming up with Inside. It would be something completely different. So I want you to kind of keep that in mind, because we're going to go back in time to the first Inside program. Before we do, when I was putting this together, I was thinking about some of the presentations I've seen in my lifetime, and I remember when I was just a young con executive, and I think we all have kind of these notions of one day I'm going to have my own advertising agency. So I'm in Detroit, you know, and I go down to the Detroit Advertising Council, and the topic of the day is how to start your own advertising agency. So my friends and I were there and eating our chicken dinners, and this very confident man gets up and said, okay, the first thing I did when I started my own advertising agency is I went to my father, who was the VP of General Motors. And I was like, that's bullshit. Like, my dad is a principal. That's not how you started an advertising agency. I don't even remember what else he said after that. So I want to tell you guys right now, there's no secret to selling really great work. There's no secrets at all. But you're going to see a lot of themes that you've seen previously, like confidence. You better believe in your product, because it's going to be a long road. There's an easy road and there's a hard road. And usually, if you're selling award-winning work, it's going to be a hard one. Believe in what you have. Believe in your staff. And don't be afraid to push back when you need to. It's a lot of hard work, as I was saying. Doing something like Inside, and we'll talk about the first one, but exponentially harder than just producing a film and putting it on the air. Exponentially harder than putting a television commercial on and optimizing the shit out of it in media. So having that passion to go to work and put in 18 hours a day to see it live and see yourself on that canned stage is something that you shouldn't forget about. It's really hard. The power to say yes. Know within your client's organization who has the power to say yes. And if your client doesn't know or pretends, don't bother. It's a very hard thing to learn. I think people who've been in the business for a long time have learned that lesson. Know who it is who has the power to say yes. And then the last thing is trust. And you can forget about the top three. Trust is really the most important if you're going to take anything away. Billy and I have developed trust over 4 years. We've had some knockdown dragouts. And because of our relationship, we know we're both on the same team. We know we're both going towards the same goal. And it's something to be earned. I know it's a cliche, but you can't go anywhere without that. So we were chosen to come here today because of the beauty inside. But I'm going to talk about the entire campaign because it might be something that you haven't heard about. And to find out how we got to the beauty inside, you really have to start with the birth of social film. And we look at this, and I think this is kind of a Brazilian trait. We like to think that we invented shit. Like, we did it first, right? Like, it's a way to really get passionate about it. We invented social film, damn it. And we want everybody to produce their own social films. So the way that we got there was through a fairly typical briefing process. This is a pitch. And what was a little atypical about it is, are you all familiar with the Intel Inside program? Intel Inside, one of the most successful global campaigns. At its core, Intel Inside is really a partnership marketing campaign, right? So you have Intel, which is inside of a Sony, or in this case, a Toshiba. So that's the pitch that we were invited to participate in. And you have a lot of smart people working on both sides, and they have to come together and brief you. So we got a lot of information, and from the Toshiba side, their positioning was all about leading innovation, but they couldn't quite narrow it down, so they couldn't leave the original, which is innovation you can trust, right? So we had to kind of wrap our head around that. At the time, Intel was about amazing things happen with Intel Inside. We're like, okay, we kind of get that. But together, it's all about exceeding expectations. Our target audience was a tech-savvy, entertainment-consuming young adult, and social media had been established in a way that it was now the norm, and people were looking for new experiences there. And then, obviously, our objectives were raise awareness, favorability, and preference. Surprisingly, no sales on there, Billy.
Not that time.
So the point of this is, if you're not fully following me here, it's very difficult. And there was a deck about that big that we really had to sift through. And the thing that really got us excited within this pitch was, they want us to push boundaries and push the rules. And that's what really led us to where we ended up. Like I said, PJ has this way of kind of cutting through the BS, for lack of a better term. He has a way of kind of synthesizing and asking the right question. It's a real talent of his. And at the time, many of you speak English as a second language. I will tell you that is often your greatest help. It is an excellent tool because it kind of sifts out all the BS and you can speak very, very clearly. So we're sitting in a briefing and people are asking questions back and forth and having a good chemistry. And PJ asked in his thick Portuguese accent, what are you desperate for? That was a horrible Portuguese accent, I know. But what are you desperate for? And we went around the room, and there were many marketing managers there, and they gave their long dissertations, and we got to Billy.
And I said, we want to be cool.
We want to be cool. And, like, to have, like, that's confidence, right? That's not sounding, trying to sound smart. It's just being honest. At the time, and still very much to this day, Apple had the corner on cool. They just want a little bit of that cool back. And they happened to have a product out at the time that was really focused on movies and entertainment and gaming. So they had the right to claim it. So we went for it. So we went back to the office and we started thinking about, okay, what if advertising were invented today? And we strongly believe, as everyone else before me stated, we believe in quality content. Quality content opens up the door. We had a lot of good questions about, you know, what's global, where are things produced? Doesn't matter. If it's quality content, your consumer's not sitting there and say, oh, was that produced in Brazil? They're like, that's fucking cool, right? Quality content opens up all the doors. Social interaction, this was a word even 4 years ago that was being batted around constantly, but you were really doing the same thing. You're passing photos, you're passing something that's funny, passing films. What if we could go a step further? What if we could get people involved in the actual piece of creative and give them actual participation within the story? And that's how we came up with social film. So a brief description of social film is you take the quality of a Hollywood movie. So you take a Hollywood director, you take a Hollywood script writer, a Hollywood style story, and hire Hollywood actors. You insert social media within there, so the viewers are actually playing a role within this movie. And with the Inside Experience, which was the first one that we did, we actually shot it and released it as if it were in real time. So are you familiar with the TV show 24? Around 24 would happen, and the next episode it would pick up in hour two, and the next episode part three. So it was happening in real time. It was the story of a woman named Christina Perasso, and she was abducted, right? Think about that. This is Intel funding this. This woman was abducted, thrown into a basement. The only thing that she had to communicate with the outside world is, thankfully, her Toshiba Intel laptop, which had excellent battery life because it was on when they turned the power off, and she could use it as a light and facial recognition. But all the features within the computer were brought to life in the story in a very natural way. It was never pushed down people's throats. When the episode would end, and there were what, eight episodes? Eight episodes. And the episode would, when episode one would end, it then would be turned over to social media. So people were talking with Christina and trying to help her and give her clues. There was we had seeded a Facebook page with Christina, so you could see that she'd been there forever, and you could see what kind of person she was, and oh my gosh, her boyfriend has a Facebook page. Maybe he's the guy who has her abducted, and oh, she's talking to her mom. All these things were pre-seeded and put onto the internet way before. Some of the challenges that we faced here is this is a new genre, so when you're going into legal with Intel and Toshiba, or you're going into, you know, the upper ranks, they're expecting a TV spot, you're coming back with something completely different.
I would actually say it's not just a new genre, it's actually a new form of entertainment. And trying to explain what social film is not easy.
It's not. The production media ratio, and I think this is something I hear a lot from my friends in Brazil. A typical ratio of production to media is about, let's just say working media, 80%, right? You have a budget of $1 million, you're going to spend $800 in working media. We said, that's not right. We can work harder if we have better content. If we have content that people want, it will be propelled through the social world. People will want to share it. We don't have to spend as much on media. Let's spend more on the quality of our production. Real-time production. Remember, this was taped sequentially, or reviewed sequentially. So we had to have people on call 24/7 for a week and a half.
11 anybody, days. When, 11 days.
11 days. Excuse
real
me.
Time. 11 days.
We set up a specific war room. All of us were there. I remember when it launched, we crashed all the servers, and everybody's screaming about, oh my God, it was a nightmare. But real-time production. And the suspension of disbelief, an interesting thing that we saw was you had the viewers And they would talk to Christina like, oh my gosh, Christina, how can I help? And then they would turn around and they'd go to the Intel website and they'd say, this is the fucking best thing I've ever seen. Christina, how can I help? So they could suspend disbelief and play along. It was something, a light bulb that never really turned off for us once we realized it was on. Billy, you want to talk about the dark subject matter and how tough that was on your side?
Sure. So let me first start with when they actually pitched the idea originally. They came to us with this concept, and as a marketer, it is very rare that you actually feel scared. And my heart was pounding. Wow. And I thought, wow, this is really interesting. I'm scared. This is exciting. Let's look at this concept. Let's dig deeper. But this didn't match the Intel brand voice, which is all about safety and reliability, and we're a very happy brand. And you know, what happened to this girl? Was she raped? How did she get there? Was she beaten up? I mean, it really opened a very dark side that we were not comfortable with. And the same with Toshiba. Toshiba is a very quirky kind of brand. At the time, they were running very funny zombie commercials. This too did not match their brand voice. And we asked the agency, you know, this is scary for us. We're not sure about it. We really love the idea. Can you come back with some additional ideas? And they went off, and they came back with six genres, six different concepts to actually do social film with. And at that time, they actually presented The Beauty Inside. And we all said, wow. And we fell in love. It was a beautiful concept. And we said, if we ever have the opportunity, we'll do that one. But we'll do it as number two. Let's move forward with the first film. And we marched forward. We were doing it. We were, you know, just about to launch. And we ran into the roadblock of lawyers. I have a lot of lawyers at Intel. There's the diversity lawyer. I mean, I have so many lawyers. There's at least five of them that I have to deal with. And up until the moment before we launched, they threatened to shut us down. And the concept was dark. It was really dark. And the only way that we won over the opportunity to get past this dark matter is that we said, you know, we will be totally transparent. At no time will we ever tell the audience that this is real. And that suspension of belief is really what came into play.
Let's take a look so you guys can kind of get an understanding of what it was all about. Here's the trailer. Spooky. We learned so much from this. Number one, we were really scared. It had never been done before. We're all in a room together, and we started seeing the views tick. We started seeing the engagement happen, and the servers crashed. And we got the servers back up, and they stayed with us, and people were engaging, and it was happening exactly how we thought it would, but only more. It was amazing. One of the other things that we learned was, I'll take you through the media first, but I'm not going to give away our secrets here. Sorry, this is kind of our secret sauce, but I thought it's interesting to kind of show what we did with this that's a little bit different. So it wasn't just a ad network buy. It really was seeded properly with the right people. We were out organically talking in chat rooms, sometimes in character, sometimes not. Wherever that was appropriate, we drew very strict lines of when we would actually break that wall. We had high impact placements. We learned that if we put a roadblock on YouTube like a movie would, people would expect a movie. And that's a really ballsy thing, because it's a movie, but you're basically saying our quality is as good as a Hollywood movie. We're really walking the walk when we do that. So we could have set ourselves up for a big letdown. but it didn't. Mobile and filled the holes with ad network. And our goal of investing in creative really worked. It really helped, and we actually won an Effie with this campaign because of that. Here's the results. Was frickin' awesome.
Frickin' awesome. I have to say this 50 million views, this film was actually initially ran just in the United States and we achieved 12 million views in the US. China, Toshiba China, saw it and said, let us rerun it, which actually brought us to 50 million. It was pretty astronomical to achieve 50 million views. I mean, when you actually look at your big blockbuster movies, there's many big blockbuster movies, can't talk, that never achieved this many people actually watching the films. And to achieve that with something that just ran in the US and just in China was pretty amazing.
Yeah, very cool. Another thing that we don't have down here but was very interesting was when we ran the casting call, we had a very small role and it was for one of Christina's friends and she was gonna help her and she had to just read a script into a camera. We got 60,000 people, who responded and wanted to be in our movie. Did really well with it. It would have been easy for us to kind of walk away and say, what's next? But we really believed in this whole new way of communication and we wanted to show that we could continue to do it. And we also had this idea that we loved. So Billy, being the demanding client that she is, would not be complacent and basically ask us, okay, what's next? And that's the beauty inside. Billy put it rather eloquently, when she requested that we go back and we look for something as an alternative to the thriller genre, and we came back with a romantic comedy, we all kind of fell in love with this story. And the story is so integral to social media and so integral to the product itself. It has that real sweet spot. And the story is about a person who every day of his or her life, they wake up in a different body. So what they're thinking is the same, but they have a different body. One day they might be a woman, the next day they might be a man. One day they might be pretty, one day they might be ugly. One day they might be really short, one day they might be really gato. What that allowed us to do is take what we learned about the casting call and cast hundreds of people to be our leading character. So when you see the cast and credits, our main character is about 100 people long. It was really special. So indulge me. Well, hold on. Let's talk about some new challenges here. It's an entirely new genre, and we talked about that. It would have been easy for us to do the thriller, to do part two, but we really wanted to establish this new way of viewing entertainment. So we did something completely different to show that we could.
I have to say here, I'm a bit of an adrenaline junkie, and going back and repeating the past and revisiting and creating a sequel just didn't quite light me up and didn't get my heart pounding. We wanted to be brave, and we really wanted to own this new form of entertainment.
I should also say, no poaching. No one poaches my client. Extend the campaign to 6 weeks. This was something that I thought, when you talk about knockdown dragouts, I didn't think it was possible. The first time was just over almost 2 weeks. We had to go to 6 weeks, and it worked.
This was really a matter of me selling it to the rest of the world. The first film was only run in the US and then in China. And Toshiba is not like Intel. They don't have a CMO. They don't have a worldwide marketing organization or a centralized marketing organization. They are individual subsidiaries around the world. And so if I want to do a worldwide campaign, I have to go and talk to each one individually and get them to come in with their money. And one of the ways I did that was talking about it being over a longer period of time. And I sold it in at a 6 week period. And as we were, really walking through the process, and of course it's early when you're selling a concept, right? You really don't know what it's gonna be. And the agency kept coming back and going, Billy, we really don't think we can do this. We really don't think we can do this. And it's like, we're doing this. It's going to be over a 6 week period.
And there's a happy ending here. We had an entirely new social engagement mechanism. In order to make the 6 weeks work, we couldn't have somebody standing by and have the constant contact that we had in the past. So what we did, as I described, we had the casting call and let people actually star in the movie.
Actually, let me just tap on international for a second, Carrie. This actually was translated into 8 different languages. And so you imagine our the center platform where this existed, where the experience lived, was Facebook. And regardless of where you were, if you were in France, or if you were in Germany, or if you were in Spain, or if you were in Japan, the experience looked like it was created for you. It was a single experience, but would translate and change based on your IP address and your language of choice. And so you had no idea that it wasn't a campaign that wasn't created for you.
Yes. So, do you want to talk about romantic comedy, or should we just go right to the film? Let's go right to the film. Okay. So, indulge me. A lot of you have seen the trailer. It was released for Cannes. I thought it would be nice to show the first episode. There were 6 episodes. This really gives you an idea of the quality of work, how integrated the product was, and also how social media and the casting call played out.
She's gonna be disappointed later. That's one of my rules. Always leave before they wake up. And I need a lot of rules. Without them, I can't do this. And my rules are my life. No one ever comes to my house. Oh, she doesn't know who I am. No one does. I was a different person last night. I was taller, I was thinner, better looking. I'll be different tomorrow, too. Every time I wake up, I'm a different person. It's been happening since I can remember. Inside, I'm always me.
I'm thinking of getting a tattoo today all over my face.
That's me today. I'm restoring antiques.
Yeah, this far. At least
for 3 months. It was
1958. Right. Molded plywood. Is it? Right? I just love the way that it tastes like pretzel.
I sell it all online, so I never have to really know anyone. My brushes with the opposite sex are always brief.
Sorry, do you mind if I sit here? I'm Alex.
Jessica.
Courtney.
Hey, Kevin.
Work in marketing.
How'd you know?
Because I've asked you before.
Just the lucky guess.
And what do you do?
I'm a singer.
I work with the homeless.
Rodeo clown. Stunt driver.
Wow, that's pretty cool. How did you end up doing that?
All journeys, they have secret destinations, which the traveler is unaware.
That's from Boober.
Where's Boober?
It's not a place, it's a guy. It doesn't matter.
You want
to
go somewhere?
It's hard to get hurt when it's always a first date.
Oh, you want to maybe go there for a nightcap?
Let's go.
I always do. And that's what it's like. That's how it goes. Every time.
And that's it for me.
Yeah, that's it for me.
Well, that's it for me.
I know that was a little long, but you don't get to Sao Paulo all the time. So,
can we talk about length for a second?
Sure.
In the first film, we actually didn't actually tell the audience when the next episode would be. And one of our key learnings walking away from that is it's much better to be predictable and to communicate to the audience when to expect the next episode. We also discovered in the first film we had, I think our longest episode was about 3.5 minutes long. And I think the shortest was maybe 23 seconds. And it was really spurred based on audience interaction when the next episode would launch, leading to that unpredictability. And what we discovered is that the audience really wanted more content. And from an advertising perspective, you know, I'm lucky if I can get a minute and a half out of somebody. And so to actually have the audience ask for more was very exciting. And we thought we were really pushing the boundaries with, I think this was 6.5 minutes long. And yet we have found that we can actually produce even longer content.
Very true. So our media strategy, we added what we call the blockbuster model. And we truly launched, we pre-launched with a trailer and pre-launched just as they would in Hollywood. So we had a big bump with our trailer and media spending, and then we kind of went dark. And then right before the premiere, we went heavy again. And then also we needed to re-engage with our previous audience. Bill, you want to?
So in the end, we had 14 different countries that actually participated in this campaign, and we produced, actually, this is not updated, it's over 70 million views worldwide. It was the sixth most watched advertising of 2012. Some of the key things here, like 96% positive sentiment rating from YouTube. I don't know how many of you read comments from YouTube, but people are mean, very honest at least. And to achieve a 96% positive rating was just amazing. You see the sales increase here. One of the key things that, as far as what's next and growing expectations, we really had to tie a sales goal to the second film, and we kind of dabbled here in the United States and really brought on Best Buy as our partner. And in exchange for exclusivity with the product that we were selling and promoting with the film, we promoted Best Buy as the only retailer in the United States. And we had an offer related to travel that I basically negotiated for free as a part of a media buy with Orbitz. And when you went to Best Buy and you bought the Toshiba laptop, you received $100 off your next Orbitz travel. And that brought sales at Best Buy from about 200 units a week in each store to over 800 units a week during the campaign. So really saw great and amazing sales results from the Beauty Inside.
I think you guys know we did pretty well at Cannes with this campaign. One thing that we're also very proud of is our Emmy Award, and it was the first commercial ever to win an Emmy Award in the U.S.
I was asking one of the Academy afterwards. I mean, it was amazing to just be nominated, right? I'm sure you hear that. Just to be nominated, it was just great. I said, but what were you thinking, right? And she said to me, you know, we know that this will be controversial in the future. And we know this will cause us problems. But she said, in the end, you deserved it. It's really quite amazing.
Aw. Well, 2013 rolled around and Billy asked, what's next? So the last 2 years, we pretty much presented all of our best ideas and she picked two. So we're like, crap, we got to think of something else. And we're not going to do something that is expected. We've done a thriller. We've done a romantic comedy, so let's try a straight up comedy. I screwed that up. We did a romantic movie, and now let's just do a straight up comedy. And this was called The Power Inside. It just wrapped up about a month and a half ago. And this was the story of, you ever notice like in key parts of history that mustaches play a role? Like some of the baddest people in history, they have a certain kind of mustache. And then mustaches fall out of fashion, and then mustaches come back, and so forth. Well, what if those were like aliens who were trying to invade the Earth, and there's this struggle going on that we don't know about? And that is the basic story behind Art at Last Inside. Our challenges are we needed to remain fresh. This is the third time we've done it. And particularly with our shop, we are always pushing ourselves. We hate to do things twice. So keeping it fresh and showing that we could do it was a discipline that we really had to honor. We need to increase global participation, and also we challenged ourselves to include other brands.
We had a dilemma with the third social film in that I did not get as much money for our media. And so one of the things that we thought of was to reach out to third-party brands and see if we could do product placement in our film and basically have advertisers pay to be in our advertisement. And that produced amazing results. I can actually talk about the ROI related to those third parties based on their involvement. They not only gave us in one case, money to actually put towards our media, but they really gave us amplification through their own channels. And then they also gave us free product to give away in a sweepstakes to gently lead someone who's watching a movie down the path to purchase, and also gave us, in the case of Skull Candy, earphones to give away with a purchase at Best Buy. When we actually went back and did the ROI analysis, and I'm kind of giving away the results of the film, but we actually established over $6 million ROI for each of the third-party brands that we brought in. So amazing ROI for them.
Selling advertising, it was a career highlight for me, for sure. Let's just get right to...
What's happening?
She's coming for you, Neil.
No!
world is relying on you. Do you understand me? The whole world, Neil?
I need a little bit more time. I think a little bit more time, and I'm okay. I'll be in, I think.
It was awesome!
Leave the stash! Everything you need to know is on that.
What does look inside yourself mean?
Any of you worth a damn in a fight?
Guys?
Guys?
Guys? They have coconut water.
Thank you. So we talked about the brand partnerships, and it was really rewarding to have a piece of content that was so valuable to other brands that they're willing to actually contribute and spread the word themselves. This just ran, so we don't have as much of the results, but the preliminaries are pretty positive.
So you can see we've moved from 50 million to 70 million, and with this last film, we're actually now over 74 million views. We actually stayed on Ad Age's top 10 viral video chart for 8 weeks, four of those in the number one position. 525 articles worldwide, and they keep coming. Here we achieved a 93% positive sentiment, and really for a sci-fi comedy where the audience actually was about 55% male, you'd think it would actually be heavier in the male space, but it actually wasn't, that this would actually be lower, so I was really pleased with 93%. We don't have it here, but I should say that our average age for all of these films is 23 years old. Our target audience was 18 to 34, so I was incredibly happy with 23 years old. We say significant increases in brand favorability. We actually achieved a 12% increase in brand favorability and a 11.9% increase in purchase consideration. And it was interesting to actually see purchase consideration because it actually went up the more content they watched, which was fabulous to see. We actually also promoted again Best Buy and partnered up again with Best Buy and sold out of the product that we had actually sold in because of the campaign. So Best Buy actually took additional product from Toshiba just because of this campaign and then sold out of it. And then Spotify, Skullcandy, Skype, and Fossil were our third-party brands. I should say that you know, it is a worldwide campaign, and doing sales for a worldwide campaign is very, very difficult. Buying a laptop is like buying a refrigerator in that you cannot go from one retailer to the next and actually directly compare them. They are unique. They are a unique SKU for that retailer. And so doing sales and driving demand is a very local effort. And we actually really kind of dabbled beyond Best Buy with Germany and in Argentina and a couple other countries where we actually were focused on delivering up the right retailer for them, again, based on their IP address and their language of choice, and had a local offer for them. And those actually achieved very good results as well.
So in closing, I'd like to just leave this slide up because I think it illustrates from an account service perspective something that I personally am very proud of and something I think everybody should strive for. A long relationship, amazing creative, and proven results. So with that, thank you.
Fantastic. Thank you, Gary, Billy.
Thank you.
Super. Really shows that.
Let me say this in English, if I may, because you don't have your. It really shows that you guys have a partnership going on. Obviously, agency client, but sometimes it may be even difficult to, you know, who's the client? Who's the agency, right? Perhaps you've got, you know, in just 4 years, you got into that kind of situation. So congratulations.
Thank you. It's a really good point. I have to say, when we initially started, we actually had three agencies come in. Of those three agencies, none of them were Intel agencies, and none of them were Toshiba agencies. And that was really purpose-driven in that we didn't want existing loyalties from an agency to Toshiba or Intel. And we didn't want them to really know how we marketed so that they could think beyond our normal way of marketing. And one of the most fascinating things with Pierre and Odell is they came into the room and they're joking with each other and they're ribbing each other and they're giving each other a hard time. And the chemistry that they had while coming in and just talking to us was one of the things that sold us the most with picking this agency. And the chemistry continues and really just, I think, makes everything go so smoothly, even when we fight.
And what role, Billy, quick question, what role would you give to Gary in terms of achieving that chemistry and you seeing, you know, the agency come through the way how it comes through? How do you see Gary's role in the agency?
He is my front lines. He is the person I rely on the most. The daily interaction, and it's really Gary and Henry, there's two on the account side. I consider them my staff. I don't have a staff, and so they are my staff. I need them to be smart. I need them to know what's coming. I need them to know what's hot and what's now. They really play a critical role of keeping me successful.
Great. Super. And I must say, it you do make quite a team, I must say. And I'll say another thing, and just picking from an earlier presentation, it takes a smart client to be brave.
Thank you.
Yeah. And the kind of work you approve shows you're really a brave client.
Oh, I appreciate that.
Congratulations.
I've been at Intel 18 years. I feel ancient every time I say that, 18 years. But the beautiful thing about Intel is that you can hop around and do something new every, 3 to 4 years if you like. I'm not your Intel norm, I would say. I've been very lucky in that I've always been put in roles where I'm expected to push the boundaries and break rules. And this was one of the most fun.
Super. Perguntas da plateia, alguém? Vamos... Temos uma aqui lá no canto, ali em cima, por favor. Microfone.
Hi, Billy. Now I'm on your, going through your question, the one you've been throwing the whole day. I've seen that you have all the results on brand favorability and purchase intent, brand perception at all. And of course, in the third movie, you've had the product sold out on Best Buy, but did you have some goals for the first two movies or all the movies that were achieved with the movies?
So with the first film, we were really, it was a branding campaign, truly just a master brand campaign. The goals there were to achieve a brand favorability in the double digits, which we far exceeded. The second film, we had sales goals, but we had sales goals just for the United States. The target there, I think, was initially whatever it was. I can't even remember to tell you the truth. We far exceeded the goals there as well. The third film, it was really to expand and really try to keep it fresh and to grow our demand experience. If we win the opportunity to do a fourth film, which I'm working very hard to try to achieve right now, demand will become even more important.
Okay, nice. Thanks.
Aqui no meio. Tá chegando aí lado esquerdo. Lado esquerdo.
The campaign, the building side, it happened only on Facebook, the platform.
I'd say that's the main platform. The video content lived on YouTube and was brought into Facebook. We also had Twitter, Instagram, a few others at the time. But Facebook was the main experience.
Was the I actually wanted to know why do you think, like, for the next social movies you're planning, do you think Facebook will be the best platform? Ooh, or
good question. Yeah. Good question. So at the time, you know, the inside experience, Facebook was it was king with the audience, the target audience. And now that target audience has really dispersed. They're on Instagram, they're on Tumblr, they're in a lot of places. And is Facebook the right platform moving forward? I can't say that. And it will really be dependent upon the concept that we decide to move forward with and what the social interaction and expectations are for the audience that will really determine what our platform is. And more than likely, we won't stick with just one platform because the audience is dispersed. We too must be dispersed.
Yeah, thank you.
I recently had a conversation with somebody who was talking about a hub. A hub is such old people thinking that you need a single place for all of the content to live, because the generation of today, the young millennials, don't really need that context. They are in all the different places, and so they don't need it all brought together in a single place.
That's where everything becomes seamless, right? Because, I mean, even the word integration, integração, we mentioned the word integration, but it's already wrong, right? Yeah. Because it when you say integration, it's as if things don't quite connect. The correct word would be seamless, right?
Yeah.
And it is totally seamless. You may be in Facebook, you may be in YouTube, you may be in Twitter, you may be in print, you may hear about it. It's everywhere. Alguém mais? Alguma outra pergunta? Acho que tem aqui para cima.
I actually, Billy, even though we have had a call already, we have to meet face to face now.
I would like that.
Afterwards, yeah. There is one thing that I think I've not asked you before, and that is, what is the role of Toshiba in the approval of the whole campaign and this whole process of having two clients? That's actually a question to both you and Gary. Thank you.
It's not easy having two masters, I can tell you. It really isn't. I have an amazing relationship with Toshiba. When I first started with Toshiba and was given Toshiba as an account, they were very unhappy and not spending their Intel Inside dollars, very frustrated with Intel. We had an opportunity at the time to really reshape co-marketing at Intel. And that's how we sold it to Toshiba, is, you know, please take a leap of faith with us and allow us the opportunity to really change things at Intel and be the impetus for that change. And I'm very lucky in that we started with Toshiba US, as we are very well aligned as far as branding is concerned and how to go about branding activities. As we have grown and become more worldwide, that has become much more complicated. Toshiba headquarters now would like input on the creative concept. Toshiba headquarters is in Japan, and the Japanese take, it's a terrible generalization, but they take forever to make a decision, if they ever make a decision. And so it's a little scary having a lot of people involved in the creative concept. And so I fall back on a very strong governance plan. And that governance plan is really driven by our RAPID model at Intel. And so for those of you that may not be familiar with the RAPID model, it's those that are recommenders, those that are agreeers, those that give input, and then the decision makers is basically it. And we've really identified who those people are within Intel and within Toshiba, and we stick by it. And if we have disagreement, I get to pull up my governance plan and go, yes, but I own the final decision, and we're moving forward.
Alguém mais? Alguma outra pergunta? Não? No? Okay. Well, Gary, Billy, fantastic. Thank you so much.
Thank you for having us.
Thank you so much for coming.
Wonderful, Gary. Thanks so much.